Such sad news this weekend on the death of Terry Venables at the age of 80, the former England manager. There have been some wonderful tributes already. And a lot of those, Jamie, have been reflecting on Terry Venables, the coach, as a football visionary. Why do you think that is?
I think because he was ahead of his time. And what I mean by that is, I think English football or English coaches were always characterised by the fact it was 4-4-2. A lot of it was sort of long ball. You think of when Terry got involved in terms of being a manager, sort of probably late 70s, those 80s. And the reason he goes from QPR to Barcelona is because he was seen as different. And, you know, tactically, he works at Barcelona. It obviously picks up things there. He then takes that to an England team in the mid-90s and they play football that, probably for a long time, we haven't seen from English players and English football right then.
He made a very big impression in a short space of time with England. Is there one game that we can look at that perhaps encapsulates what Terry Venables was about as a coach?
Well, everyone knows it's the Holland game. And it's not just the performance that night. It was the fact who the opposition was. And they almost took on Holland and beat them at their own game. Nobody'd expect England to beat Holland, being aggressive, long balls, set pieces, and, you know, maybe being defending deep. This was completely different. This was sort of Holland at that time sort of had Ajax in the mid-90s, great players. We see some of the names there. Don't forget, half of this team has won the Champions League the year before. Half the team, again, has played in the Champions League final a few months before. So this is the calibre of opposition that we're talking about. And England took them on at their own game and wiped the floor with them.
So have a look at the team then.
Well, you see, I mean, you look at that team and it's almost a team, I think, at Euro 96. There wasn't too much changing, really. I mean, David Platt came in now and again when people were suspended. But you actually look at that team, I mean, absolute world-class players there. There's absolutely no doubt about that. But the great thing about this tournament, that was the team. It didn't change too often, as I said, and some real legends of English football there.
So how did he make what looked like on paper a 4-4-2 something very different?
Well, he did, and that's what it was characterised as, like, for English football, played, you know, 4-4-2. But he did do things differently. You know, we see here the Dutch, they're playing, you know, a 3-4-3. We associate that with them. But when you actually look at this England team, we look at it now as a 4-4-2. But I studied this game a couple of years ago and looked at it tactically. It was interesting listening to Gary before the game yesterday talk about his role within this. So the shape, actually, when England were without the ball, was pretty similar to this. And you'd have Sheringham at times, obviously, dropping into those positions. But what really stood out, looking at this game, and we watched it again this morning, a few of the highlights, was what England did with the ball that was different. And Gary mentioned yesterday about, at times, he almost felt like a right winger. Gareth Southgate would come across, Stuart Pearce here, Steve McManaman in these positions. And then what you'd get is that sort of 3-4-3 that we associate even now with Pep Guardiola, you know, in terms of playing out, how do you build up? And you think of Tony Adams stepping in here with the ball. Gareth Southgate now, what he's asking his England defenders to do, to step in with the ball. And what was really evident was the rotation of movement constantly between players. At times, Sheringham was actually coming deepest for the ball. Paul Ince was pushing up. Let's not forget, Paul Ince actually makes a run into the box, gets a penalty, and he's supposedly your holding midfield player. So the actual movement of players, like I said, Anderson in here, at times Shearer was making a lot of runs down this channel. So it was things that we hadn't really seen before. Normally players were set in stone. You play there, you don't move out of position. That was the difference with this England team and certainly this game.
And a key goal as well, that they managed to get themselves the real flowing move that we sort of associate with this game.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm trying to take this back to sort of what we see now in football. And when we talk about pressing from the front, centre-backs high up the pitch, you know, players moving around in positions where you're not quite sure who should be picking who up. And I think that the famous goal, I think, was the third goal. And it's not just great football. It comes from England, as I said, being high up the pitch. McManaman and Darren Anderton found themselves on the same side of the pitch. Sheringham was up here as well. But what really stood out was the fact that England's centre-backs were really high up the pitch. Tony Adams wins a ball here on the halfway line, as we would see now a Virgil van Dijk in that position, Ruben Dias for Manchester City. He wins the ball, he then gives it to the magician, Paul Gascoigne in this role, and he plays a couple of one-twos and he ends up finding himself in this position. But the fact you had the two wide players on the same side, in the mid-90s, that would have been unheard of. What are you doing? Your job's to get over back over the other side. But Alan Shearer, obviously great striker, Sheringham as well, they see the situation. Alan Shearer just finds himself then as the right winger, and didn't it pay off? So there's a lot of interchanging here. The ball, as we know, comes into Sheringham. We feel like he could take the shot on. He doesn't. He rolls it to Alan Shearer, and Shearer fires in just here. And we see the shot there of Alan Shearer putting it past a goalkeeper of the calibre of Edwin van der Sar. And that was just almost a top hat on an unbelievable performance, an unbelievable time, Euro 96, that we all look back to.
But you've talked about pretty much Terry Venables using the same players through the tournament. But did he have the ability to use those same players in very different roles?
I think that was his big strength as a coach, you know, reading the game, changing things in-game as well. And you talk about the Holland game, actually the game before that against Scotland, you talk about Gareth Southgate's role there, and he was actually into midfield and it was actually a back three. And so Gary is talking about him playing as a conventional right-back in this tournament. He's then playing as a right-sided centre-back. In one of the games, he played as a wing-back. And I think that probably just sums it up. And again, you look at that sort of system, and again, it's very Dutch-like. When you think about, you know, the great Holland team's total football, a lot of it was 3-4-3. So I think that was a huge influence on him, certainly being at Barcelona as well with their Dutch influence. And the big change he made in the Scotland game was actually bringing Jamie Redknapp on. I think Stuart Pearce goes off, Gareth Southgate goes back into the back three, and we'll use Stuart Pearce here almost like he's Jamie Redknapp. But Jamie Redknapp came on and dictated the game from there because it wasn't going well first half. And that was his ability to actually change a game, see what the problem was, and then go and fix it.
You've played for England under several different managers. How different do you think is it that sort of special ability that Terry Venables had to almost win the trust of these players so quickly to get them to buy in to what were, at the time, very different methods?
What I always find a lot of the time with managers, they almost fall into two different categories. You've got the man manager who the players really like, and he's maybe got a coach looking after the training sessions and the tactical input of a game. And then you might have the flip side of that, who's someone who's really analytical, knows what to do with the team and how to set them up, but he hasn't got those man management skills and that camaraderie with the players. I think that's why when you listen to some of the players from the Euro 96 team speak about Terry Venables today, it's because he had both. And you very rarely get that. And that's why he was such a special manager. And you see that with certainly the clubs that he managed, the top one being Barcelona, winning a league title there, getting to a European Cup final. And possibly this, in terms of Euro 96, a moment where everybody remembers and England come so close. That's happened a few times in the past. But the actual football he played and the way they went about it and how he improved players as well, I think is a testament to sort of why everybody is speaking so glowingly about Terry Venables today.
I think you're right. You've heard it this weekend. Universal praise for the manager, the coach, and also the man manager. He had that ability to get the most out of all these players that gave us those terrific moments of Euro 96 for everyone and anyone who was part of it at the time. Terry Venables, such a sad loss to football, died this weekend at the age of 80.